have cashed out prosperity, almost literally in terms of money and economic growth. And we've grown our economies so much that we now stand in a real danger of undermining hope. Running down resources, cutting down rainforests, spilling oil into the Gulf of Mexico, changing the climate. And the only thing that has actually remotely slowed down the relentless rise of carbon emissions over the last 2 to 3 decades is recession. And recession, of course, isn't exactly a recipe for hope either. So we're caught in a kind of trap. It's a dilemma of growth. We can't live with it, we can't live without it. But I want to concentrate on the role of investment in seeking out novelty, because it turns out that human beings have something of an appetite for novelty. We love new stuff, new material stuff for sure, but also new ideas, new adventures, new experiences. But the materiality matters too, because in every society that anthropologists have looked at, material stuff operates as a kind of a language of goods, a symbolic language that we use to tell each other stories. Stories, for example, about how important we are. Status-driven, conspicuous consumption thrives from the language of novelty. Adam Smith, 200 years ago, spoke about our desire for a life without shame. In his day, what that meant was a linen shirt. And today, well, you still need the shirt, but you need the hybrid car, the HD TV, 2 holidays a year in the sun, the netbook, an iPad, the list goes on. Even if we don't want them, we need to buy them, because if we don't buy them, the system crashes. Who are we? Are we these novelty-seeking, hedonistic, selfish individuals? Or might we actually occasionally be something like the self depicted in Rembrandt's lovely sketch here? There is a tension between self-regarding behaviors and other-regarding behaviors, and these tensions have deep evolutionary roots. So selfish behavior is adaptive in certain circumstances, fight or flight. But other regarding behaviors are essential to our evolution as social beings. And perhaps even more interesting from our point of view, another tension between novelty seeking behaviors and tradition or conservation. Novelty is adaptive when things are changing and you need to adapt yourself. Tradition is essential to lay down the stability, to raise families and form cohesive social groups. So here, all of a sudden, we're looking at a map of the human heart. And it reveals to us suddenly the crux of the matter. What we've done is we've created economies. We've created systems which systematically privilege, encourage one narrow quadrant of the human soul. And left the others unregarded. And in the same token, the solution becomes clear, because this isn't, therefore, about changing human nature. It isn't, in fact, about curtailing possibilities. It is about opening up. It is about allowing ourselves the freedom to become fully human. Recognizing the depth and the breadth of the human psyche, and building institutions to protect Rembrandt's fragile altruist within. What does all this mean for economics? We need the economy to reconceive investment. Only now, investment isn't going to be about the relentless and mindless pursuit of consumption growth. Investment has to be in the new economy, protecting and nurturing the ecological assets on which our future depends. It has to be about transition. It has to be investing in low carbon technologies and infrastructures. We have to invest in the idea of a meaningful prosperity, providing capabilities for people to flourish. And of course, this task has material dimensions. It would be nonsense to talk about people flourishing if they didn't have food, clothing, and shelter. But it's also clear that prosperity goes beyond this. It has social and psychological aims: family, friendship, commitment, society, participating in the life of that society. And this, too, requires investment. Investment, for example, in places where we can connect, places where we can participate, shared spaces, gardens, concert halls, public parks, libraries, museums, places of joy and celebration, places of tranquility and contemplation. Prosperity is a shared endeavor. Its roots are long and deep. Its foundations exist already inside each of us. What we're doing here is we're taking a few simple steps towards an economics fit for purpose. And at the heart of that economics, we're placing a more credible, more robust, and more realistic vision of what it means to be human.